Port Adelaide's ruckman Russell Johnson returns to the field and Glenelg takes on West Adelaide at Richmond. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Seven's Big League. Well, extremely warm conditions for football in Adelaide this afternoon, and after round five, I would say that in our ranks tonight, we'd have some pretty tired league footballers after spending something like 100 minutes running around the football arena this afternoon. In Seven's Big League tonight, the two games we've got coming your way, from Football Park, league leaders North Adelaide take on Port Adelaide, and from down at Richmond, West Adelaide against Glenelg, and our special guests in the studio tonight, Peter Murett from West Adelaide and Dwayne Russell from Port Adelaide. And also, just a little later in the program, your first opportunity of season 1985 to win one of those NEC colour televisions in our Mark of the Month competition for April. Just a sidelight to today's games played in Adelaide, there were, we believe, three reports made at Football Park, a sensational opening to the game out there between North Adelaide and Port Adelaide. We do believe that David Tiller and Peter Bennett were reported before the opening bounce, and also down at the Adelaide Oval today, Brett Nonner was reported in the third term for South Adelaide. Let's now just take a look at the scores from the other games played in Adelaide this afternoon, and we see Sturt, 26 goals, 18, 174 points, defeating Woodville on 17 goals, 7, 109. Obviously the influence of the dumping of Rick Davies having no effect on Sturt this afternoon. Torrens, 23-19, 157, defeating Central, 16-11, 107. And Norwood, 20 goals, 11, 131, accounting for the Panthers, 14 goals, 9, 93. Graham Campbell, Keith Conn and myself were at Football Park this afternoon for the game between North Adelaide and Port Adelaide. And Graham, really, what more can you do but win your first five games of the season?
Well, that's right, Rick. And, you know, North Adelaide are doing it easily at the moment. They simply have too much firepower up forward for sides like Port Adelaide, and they have a competent back line led by Michael Armfield today, particularly, and David Clisby, is it? And Trevor Clisby. Yeah. He did well also, but they have too much going for them at the moment, North. They have, as I said, a live wire rover also in Tony Antipas, who kicked three goals and gave them plenty of sparkle around the packs. And poor old Port, they are definitely missing the likes of Tim Evans at full forward and a centre man of the likes of, Craig Bradley in the middle. They need them desperately if they're going to get back into the game of winning league football matches. And their one winner today was the boy on the wing, Greg Anderson. He sparkled all day from his side of the ground and gave them some sort of a lift, but they simply don't finish off their work upfield. They haven't got a forward of any sort of life at all, and they fell for the old trap of changing their ruckman at full forward, something I really frown upon, and it didn't work all day. And Russell Ebert is struggling a little also. He replaced himself at half-time and saw the game from the bench to complete last half of the match, and it simply isn't working out up forward for Port Adelaide at the moment. And I don't know where they go from here, I really don't. One win out of four isn't good enough, while North Adelaide doing it easily. Five wins out of five matches, and they've got nothing to worry about at the moment.
How big a part did Russell Johnston play in the game in his return today, Graham?
Well, sadly, he started on the bench. Well, I say sadly because I feel the man needs to open up the ruck and give them some sort of impetus early in the game. He started on the bench. He had a little bit of work around about the 20-minute mark of the first quarter, came on again during the second quarter, and played the entire last half virtually out of a back pocket. And, you know, the man has too much to offer to play that sort of a role. He may still be carrying some sort of an injury, in all fairness to Russell. But at the moment, no effect on their game whatsoever, Robert.
At the Richmond Oval today, we had the team down there of Ian Day, Peter Marker and Robert Odie. And Robert, really just looking at the scoreboard for that game down there, a pretty close one in the end, but Glenelg somewhat jumped the starting gun.
They certainly did, although it was a bit of a slow start, Rick. It was 11 minutes, in fact, and West Adelaide kicked the first goal, and it was into the breeze. Glenelg had won the toss. They'd played pretty well. They'd moving the ball fairly quickly, but on the other hand, one couldn't deny West. They keep moving it up to half forward, but they couldn't seem to get it into that forward line, right into Roger Luders. They could get it up to the half forward area, but no further than that. There was no team play that was running the ball right into the goal. The game was certainly fast and furious, though. There was no beg your pardons whatsoever. It was a fantastic game of football, and I thought that Glenelg were going to go on with it in this first quarter, and at quarter time they led, in fact, 7-5 to 3-2. Chris McDermott in that first quarter was fantastic. He carried on his very good form of past weeks. His play across the centre of the ground was excellent, and I thought that, well, they look as though they're going to go on with the business. But it was a pretty hot day, and a few players really started to feel the pinch during the second quarter. And the game sort of died a little bit, not that much happened. Dreher was shifted into defence. He started in the forward pocket, which was rather a strange one as far as we were concerned. But he went back into defence, and he didn't look to be moving all that well. He was sort of struggling slightly, and he ended up going back into the forward line again after his stint in the defensive area. Westies weren't having much luck with injuries. They lost Grosser. They lost, just after half-time, they lost Smith with a very bad shoulder injury, and they certainly missed him. And I thought, well, that's the end. Miller pulled hamstring muscle and they were in strife. But Grantley Filkey somehow or other found something as a rover. It was fantastic watching him move. He was doing something that Glenelg weren't. Glenelg were playing very wide. Even Stephen Kernahan, with his height and that, was going out to the half-forward flank and playing very wide to receive his kicks coming up ground. It was enabling players to block in that forward area, West Adelaide players, I mean, and Glenelg couldn't get a smooth run at the goal. And as a result, there was no finishing of their play. And West Adelaide, they attacked back down the centre. And Grantley Filkey was certainly very exciting. And Clayton Lamb on the half-back line, together with, at centre-half-back, Craig Williams, were playing magnificent games. And at half-time, Glenelg were 10-9 and Westies were 8-5. And West Adelaide were hanging in there, injuries and all aside. And it was during the third quarter, in fact, that Smith went off when he hurt his shoulder. And from half-time, it was a dour struggle. And we couldn't quite work out who was going to be in front. And about 15 minutes into the quarter, Westies had kicked 3-4 to 4 straight goals by Glenelg. And Glenelg were kicking with the breeze during that time. But it was certainly a magnificent game of football. And perhaps West Adelaide had a lot to savour today, because with a very limited number of players, they certainly played some very good football.
Thanks for that first half summary, Robert. We'll now go down to Richmond Oval. We'll pick up play at the 15-minute mark of the third quarter. Glenelg 14-9, lead West Adelaide 11-9.
Peter Barr, the distance is almost an action replay of the first. Seabone kicking in towards Walsh, in front Herbert, fine mark. Held his ground well, short as Conlon. Boyd put it up, he's going to have to stay his ground. And DeBaye, player then, didn't make a great effort to mow him down. I thought it could have blown him to rest, but he just couldn't raise that extra gallop to get there. And Conlon's got it from 35 metres out. Maybe his set shooting for goal is better. It sure is if it's made the distance. The umpire says goal. 13 kick Conlon. Goal number one. 14-9 Glenelg, 12-9 West Adelaide.
Well, that kick across the centre of the ground then. West Adelaide still looking for each other. They're prepared to take the chance. Robin Kidney a little slow to pick up Conlon. He just perched himself at centre half forward to receive that kick, which was the result of a very good mark, a stretching mark by Des Herbert.
16 minutes into the third quarter. The Bloods trial by two kicks, two goals. Micken and Carey. Ineffective out of the centre, although Marshall gives it to Hall. He runs through the centre. Great smother by Clayton Lamb. McDermott very cleverly kicks it through to Kernahan. Luck's a fortune as Kernahan turns around. Off straight through the centre. Two goals, Kernahan. A bit of luck, you might say, off the boot of McDermott then, but the footballers can turn those things to their advantage, and Kernahan's one of those players.
The interesting thing about that play was the way that Tony Hall was able to run through the middle of the ground then. In fact, he ran right through the circle, exactly the space that all the players had contested the ball in. And how often it happens in a football match, in fact, as players fly for the ball, all of a sudden this great hole appears in the middle of the ground, and Tony Hall made no mistake when he attacked it right through there to put the ball in front, and well in front now.
Carey against Micken, who's been winning the tap. He got his hand to the ball first then. Randall Bennett couldn't get out. He's going to get a free kick for his troubles. He gets it from centre field, puts it high up for Conlon and Gibbs. Gibbs too tall, too strong, takes a fine mark. Gibbs has Marshall leading for him. It's going towards that player. Marshall always has the ability to pick up kicks like that, dropping into the open, and he dispatches it with his normal accuracy to Henwood. Close to the line, hooks around the corner. Catalaptis is going to work hard for it, and he does, and gets it in the back pocket. Lamb is on the outer side. He gets past Kidney. Now he's got a change tack. Back to shore. The big fella's going to have to work hard. Micken's awkward-looking kick is going to find Tony Hall. He can't quite get it. Conlon can. Sleight of hand of Folding. Folding bolts. Out comes Luders. Oh, he's got it. I thought Herbert or Smith was going to cut him off. He had one hand up, but Luders must have caught him. He dropped it quickly, and Luders has taken the mark on his chest about 35 metres out. His last kick was not a good one. That's a better looking kick, but no better result. Off the line, 1 point only, 12-10 West Adelaide, 15-9 the Bays.
Well, all I can say is that Mike Smith must know the sound of Roger Luders' voice. As he appeared committed to that ball, Mike Smith. Roger Luders just picked it up very neatly. Seabone playing it, certainly kicking off. One hand up, Bickett. Ross Gibbs. Casual kick smothered by Rennie. The Conlon handball was too quick. McGuiness has fallen out of the game a bit. since that ankle injury. A blind handball from Hamilton works for Rennie. A chance now for Andrews. Through goes Smith, picking the ball up. Fantastic work, Bennett. Kick away is offline, though. Only the point. Smith is down on the ground. He appears to have an elbow problem or a shoulder problem here.
Yes, he's hurt, Peter, but what a brilliant tackle there by John Seabone. Bennett just hesitated momentarily as he got through the pack, and I agree with you, it was a brilliant take, a lot of courage, and Seabone just got the pressure on him to stop him taking or getting the kick. Mark has been paid to Micken, Andrews down, West Adelaide with problems, two players on the bench with leg injuries, and now I think we've got a stretcher for Andrews. They've called, no, he's going straight off though. And it looks like it's a shoulder problem. Smith, not Andrews. But it's Micken's kick going right in towards full forward. Luders and Folding. Thumb clear. The first recover is big Andrews. Andrews will need help. Back to Randall Bennett. 10 metres out. Dummies. Pops it in the air. Close. The umpire says goal. Bennett's first. West Adelaide, despite their problems, battling on. Trail 13-11 to 15-9.
So Randall Bennett kicks the ball. Smith leaves the arena never to return. They've obviously made sure that he's not going to come back on. He's obviously got an injury that's no good. But that was a great take then by Randall Bennett. He just propped himself quickly, set himself for the goal, and came around as he came around McGuiness. Well done. And West Adelaide playing with a great deal of aplomb under adverse circumstances.
They're in trouble. Stephen Miller's on the ground. Mike Smith coming off. Miller's right thigh is heavily bandaged, and all he can do is limp at the moment. Things suggesting a Bay victory. Out of the blocks comes Copping. He's starting to hurt them now, Copping.
Drill limping.
Who's not limping?
They're in trouble, Westie boys.
Mike Smith has played very well, by the way, for the Bloods. He's kicked two goals and he's done a lot of hard body work. One thing we noticed a little while ago, he's certainly got a great deal of pace, Mike Smith. He's getting a warm ovation from the Blood supporters as he goes off. Copping has finally missed one. He's threatened to miss on the last two occasions where he's just snuck them in. 15-10 Glenelg, the Bloods 13-11.
Bad luck for Mike Smith and West Adelaide. Shaw the kick in to Micken. Carey there as well, tapped over the back. Simons hooks the ball high. Didn't get a great deal of distance. Hedwood underneath the ball. Comes down to McDermott, kicks in high. Kernahan, Shaw, Kernahan at the back of the pack. Copping hooks back. Oh, missed by a proverbial kilometre. Had to get it onto his boot very quickly, but he was in the right spot. 15-11 plays 13-11.
21 and a half minutes into this third quarter. Might need a new ball after that one. Yes, as we've said, the Bloods do have problems, but one thing they don't have a problem with, and that's the size of their hearts.
And their teamwork's been good, hasn't it, Peter? Things haven't been going well, but they've really tried to find each other with limited players. They know they can't kick blind kicks because there's loose players around the ground, and they've really tried hard to advantage the ball.
Well, can they get up? What a lion-hearted performance from Mark Micken. He loves doing all the work, and he does it very well. Herbert, Clayton Land's been a top player. Gee, he's clever. His ball control is second and none. Clayton Lamb. Herbert's kick wasn't the best. Marked by Gibbs.
I don't think his leg will swing anymore. I think he's really worked them to full capacity.
He's run himself into a hole, I think. The free kick will go to Williams. It went against Hedwood. He'll have to go back, though. Behind the mark. Those are the rules. Hedwood standing the mark. He let him go that time because he was behind. Still got a bit of pace. Shoots it out. Murett. He made a few yards. Murett to mark that ball. Andrews wants it in around centre-half forward area. Murett might have to kick the goal himself the way he's going. Gee, that's a superb looking kick. Coming back. There's a mark there. Andrews has taken it. That was Harry Houdini work, that was. No one knew what anybody was doing in the square. After Andrews, he just floated in and took the mark. This is his fifth kick. That's his fourth goal. I'll tell you what, that's a move that was forced upon John Carl Robert, but it certainly worked for him.
Player in the club rooms there, Mike Smith, he's in a bit of trouble with that arm. It wouldn't surprise me if he hasn't dislocated a shoulder. He certainly is in a lot of pain. He's trying to relax himself. But West Adelaide, they've certainly carried on despite their injuries. And it's a credit to them the way they've played. They're probably saying, why can't we play like this when everyone's at full capacity?
Yes, he's ruefully looking at his shoulder. And, of course, the head trainer having to take off his shoes. Bilkey comes to meet the ball well. Caught on the left leg, wobbles one to the half forward line. Coming to meet it is Murett, showing a lot of pace, but he got a bad bounce. Stringer goes for the safety of the line. Getting there quickly is Filkey, but not soon enough, and the ball is out of play.
Yes, Mark Dreher is resting up forward now, Ian, and he's limping noticeably at this stage.
Dislocated collarbone, Mike Smith, what bad luck. That'll be a few weeks. Kernahan in ruck now. The tap is towards McKinnon. Miller can't raise a gallop. He's got that bandage, heavily bandaged. Or was it Luders who looks like he's struggling too? Simon's got it away. Fine mark, Des Herbert. He'll get it back to Rennie. Short is sure. That's the way the ball will go. He thought about Lamb. He could get run down, but gets the kick away up towards full forward. The walking wounder up there. Big mark. I think it's
Murett.
It's Murett. Oh, players coming from everywhere. West Adelaide running on hard alone. They haven't got a good leg amongst them. Herbert holding his hip as well. Walking wounded everywhere. Murett into the pack, took a fine mark. And wouldn't this bring the roof down? If he kicks this goal, it will tie up the ball game. Kick number 9, going away from Peter Murett. Yet to boot a goal. He hits the woodwork. What an anti-climax. 14-12, plays 15-11, and Doug Thomas cannot believe it.
Well, I'll tell you what, the picture tells the story. They've got everything against them at the moment, the Bloods, and when the odds are down, the men with heart stand up. Away goes Tony McGuiness. He loves doing this. He's running very quickly. He's had 5 bounces. He's run 100 metres. Shoots it over the top now. The airball wasn't the best. Comes back now to McDermott. He puts it up again to McGuiness. This may come unstuck in a second. Henwood back to McGuiness. It's a fairy tale if he kicks it. It's just offline. 1 point. 15-12 Glenelg, 14-12 the Bloods.
They don't seem to be able to get the ball in the centre of the ground here. They're running it around the boundary line, staying very wide on those attacks. They did it last quarter too, and I think it's what's getting them into a bit of trouble.
Up goes Simons.
One goal for McGuiness' kick.
Well, he's been inaccurate. Simons couldn't quite take the mark on that occasion. Have a look at Des Herbert.
He's gone.
I think he'd like a spa bath at the moment, Des.
No, just going tonight, I wouldn't think. Meckin, who's doing well against Carey, got his body there. Carey can't get out of handball, and umpire Hilton calls for a halt. 14-12 to 15-12, a goal to difference into time on in the third quarter. The Bays in attack, Henwood up high. Lamb through for the blood, hooks it back towards the centre line. Luders out now, Kernahan over the top, fine mark. Well, Luders is at centre wing at the moment. I think he's been moved to centre half forward. Marshall gives the lead. Big Shaw back there. Marshall the mark. Quickly out to Simon. Simon's under pressure. Gets out of it well. David Kernahan puts out a pass. McGuiness coming across. Rennie does it well. The pass was not good. It was a flutter. He had to wait for it. Randall Bennett, the running player. Marshall closing on him. Bennett gets rid of the ball in a hurry. And the umpire said he's hanging on. He obviously handballed to himself. He only had one hope in Hurt, and that was to get a free kick for him, hanging on, because there was 2-on-1 out there and he had no place to go. That looked like a shove as well, and the umpire is sympathetic, and the free kick will go on the outer side to Peter Murett. He's almost out at centre wing at the moment. Murett, like a lot of West Adelaide players, is starting to lift in time of adversity. Murett puts it across to Hamilton. Oh, he's under the hammer from Simons. Simons spoils. Big Shaw's got a lumber after all. Stringer, courage personified. Gets the free kick. Ducked his chutney, but did it well. Stringer to the half forward line.
Gee, a great surprise then that Murett tried that kick. But it looks like he's going to get out of trouble with Faulding. He hooks it around. Filkey, big danger here for West Adelaide. Glenelg players everywhere. McDermott ducked the head. Got it back to David Kernahan. Well done, Des Herbert. And West Adelaide live again. Gee, a couple of untidy kicks then. One from Murett, one from Faulding. Glenelg unable to capitalise on it or on either. Kernahan David Kernahan. See, there's a few Glenelg players that are a bit tired too. They're not carrying injuries though. Murett, super handball. Des Herbert, here's a go. Filke, he might kick the goal himself as he runs through half forward. Under the ball though is Stringer. It's offline, a point. The Bloods 14-13, Glenelg 15-12.
Apparently Filke's had enough plays today, Ian, on that straight in play. They're like practice runs, aren't they? And he obviously hasn't got a good line of his run at the goal. He needs to really practice that.
He's had the chances. Stephen Barrett, free kick. High tackle, Murett. Barrett down. I think he probably only winded. Murett was committed. But Barrett, equal to the task in courage, stood his ground and took a fine mark. Stephen Barrett from inside the half back line, up towards Marshall, missed it. Henwood back there. With him now is Craig Williams. Good handball to McKinnon. McKinnon duck one. He could get run down by Marshall. Put down a pass all the way. And once again, it's Mr. Cool in Ross Gibbs who comes to meet the ball. Pushes it to the outer side for David Kernahan. Miller can't raise a gallop with that torn thigh muscle. And he in turn will go centre field for Marshall. Didn't give him much of a chance as Clayton Land thumps clear. But it was straight to Barrett. All clear out there for Kernahan. He can take the ball home. Now Stringer over the half forward line. He thought about the pass. Now goes for home with a long one. But all the umpire goes galloping well offline for a point. And the Bays are 15-13, West Adelaide 14-13.
Ominous signs though for the Bloods. Up forward, they've got no one. Salisbury getting ready to come on. The kick is to Bennett. If the Bloods win this, they...
Don't do it, Pete.
I'll tell you what, they'll certainly go up in my estimation. Off it goes to Hamilton. He runs through centre wing. Floats one up forward. Andrew is showing a lot of pace. Should have marked it. Under a bit of pressure. The kick off the ground through to Ross Gibbs. A short chip out towards Simons. Andrew's after him. Can't catch him. Tell you what, the crowd love relief. McDermott is on centre wing. Through goes Simons. So not they're doing all the attacking the Bays. They can't kick goals though. Copping off hands. McGuiness. Clayton Land. What a game he's played. Cataleptus. Herbert. The handball back down and ready. He's going to get run down. Gets the kick away though. Filke. G. Murett a chance. The siren might beat Murett. Must be very close. He runs through half forward. The kick on the way. Coming back. Offline, only the point. Sheik.
Peter, if that had gone through, the whole lift, the roof would have gone off this stadium. West Adelaide fans just aching for them to hit the front. Gunsy performance, but the Bays equal to the task at the moment. Gibbs back up towards Shaw and Kernahan. Off the fingers, Bennett. Good tackle on by Duthie. He's out from defence. Quickly now it's Wayne Stringer. Drives to the half forward line. Henwood gives chase with Williams towards the line. And the ball goes out of play. It's been a stirring third quarter. 14-14 West Adelaide, 15-13 Glenelg. 7 minutes of time on in this quarter. Throw in, it's going to be Shaw and Henwood. Henwood got it back to Simons. Siren sound, three-quarter time. Glenelg 15-13, West Adelaide 14-14.
Richmond Oval, the Bays leading by 5 points, but the Bloods have got big problems. They're running on half at the moment. Williams in ruck, off hands, McDermott playing a top first half. Simons, Gibbs. Gibbs has been a good player. McGuiness still with run, kicks with the right boot. Kernahan, use the body. Derek Shaw will take the free kick at half back. Ronnie Andrews has been a find for the Bloods. He's kicked 4 goals. Up there in the forward area, Luders has kicked 3. Up goes Luders now, he's playing at 10.5 forward. They've made plenty of moves. Bottleneck there, tack side of centre for the Bloods. The umpire will ball it up. Miller is on the ground in the forward pocket. He appears to have a pulled hamstring muscle. Gives to Simons. There were danger signs up in the third quarter for the Bloods. The run is on. Kernahan, Simons. Trouble? No, they're in trouble. 15 metres. Simons. Simons is being retarded. 15-metre penalty, and they've got a chance to bring up first blood in this last quarter. Simons' kick won't make the distance. Copping in front. The punch away came. Kidney and Cantalactus. Kidney's going to get a free kick. In the pocket, as Fulting was running away with the ball. Against Cantalactus, he's given away a few free kicks today. A couple of them intentionally to stop the Glenelg run. Robert Kidney, who played a superb first 15 minutes of this game, kicked a miraculous goal in the first quarter. Won't score a goal with that one. Oh, gee. Alan Stringer nearly took the mark. He didn't realise the ball was on him. 6 points up, Glenelg. 15-14 to the Bloods, 14-14.
One straight kick, the difference. Can the Bloods hang on with courage alone? Williams gets a lead from Clayton Lamb. Now it's covered by Henwood. Lamb up. Henwood spoils. Hanging on. Henwood's free kick. The Bay seem to have the game covered, but only time will tell. Stringer. West Adelaide's fight back has been very courageous. Stringer's 12th kick going in towards full forward. Micken up behind is Fulting. In turn ready, close to the line. He won't keep that in and it's out of play. The Bay's led by 27 points at quarter time, 16 points at half time, and West Adelaide whittled that down to 5 at three quarter time, but a great personal loss. Randall Bennett heaves the ball back towards centre field. Marshall. Also, Hamilton got it out. Conlon shows his pace. He's got three to beat. Scotty Salisbury on the ground. Gets out the handball to Marshall. He fades this way, that away. Gives it back now to Kernahan. Kernahan beats Conlon. Puts it in high to the half forward line. Carey comes to meet it. Quickly now in there is Kidney. With him, Cantalactus. And he's going to get the free kick this time. Gets it out to Lamb. Lamb thought about using Williams. He does. Now in turn, Herbert. West Adelaide mounting and run. Over the centre line goes Herbert, looking for a lead. None forthcoming. Now out comes Dreyer. In there is Luders as well. Dreyer at the back of the pack. Can run into the open goal, and that's it. That's tied up the ball game. Dreyer's first goal. West Adelaide 15-14. Glenelg 15-14. You can't get it any closer than that.
So a careless free kick on the half forward line by Glenelg to John Cantalactus. Saw the ball get across to Craig Williams. Williams with a nice long handball. Plenty of weight on the shot. Gave it across to Des Herbert. And Des Herbert sent it forward. And off hands it came. And Mark Dreher, cool as you like, just left two Glenelg players flying in the air and just bowed out of it and took it off the hands and kicked an easy goal.
Well, Andrews, Miller and Dreher are the three main forward players up there for West Adelaide. They've got problems. Luders back to Herbert. What a game Herbert's played today. Player falling down there was Andrews. Couldn't take the mark. Hall runs away with it. McDermott in the open space. Puts it back to Gavin Walsh. The handball to Wayne Stringer. Not accurate. Stringer has got time, though, to pick up and kick to Kernahan. Always a danger, Stephen Kernahan. Henwood wants it at centre-half forward. McDermott provides the run. Copping's the man in front. Micken in there. Carey! Push in the back, though. That will go to Micken. Micken was worried about two players then, Copping and Carey. He got a sharp and a free kick. He handballs back. Des Herbert still running. I don't know if he'll be running like that in about 15 minutes, though. Kernahan, too tall for Bennett. What a good mark. That's David Kernahan, 13 kicks. Dropping in front, the punch away comes. McGuiness, beautiful take. Alan Stringer, still got plenty of go. That could score a goal, oh it does! Mark Micken wasn't really sure of where he was. Carey did all the spoiling that he could do in the shepherding. That was the first goal to Stringer. 16-14 the Bays, 15-14 the Bloods.
Stringer did that absolutely magnificently then. We've watched him play during the day and for the last few weeks, and at no occasions he committed himself to a ball like he committed himself to that one. He took the ball, one grab, came in between the players, and he really tried to finish it off, and the goal was deserving of the play.
Williams against Henwood at the centre bounce. Williams tap away. Coming through is Hamilton. Gets out the handball wild. McKinnon. Bounce favours Marshall. Hawkshaw. Stringer on his line if he can find it. Stringer's got it. 15 metres. Stringer an extra play on. Puts it in long. Puts it in high. A goal! Oh, what a brilliant effort. Fording wonders what he's got to do to get a free kick. The West Adelaide crowd don't like it. But the fact remains, Stringer has booted goal number two in a minute. And Glenelg clear out by those two goals to lead 17-14 to 15-14.
That was another great lifting goal by Alan Stringer. The bit of play that he got the 15 metres from, I don't think was too uplifting. I think it was the sort of play that grand finals are lost with. And the coolness that was required was done with the kick only.
The bounce in the centre. Glenelg have got the break, which we perhaps thought they might. McDermott caught. Holding the ball, they yelled. The umpire on that occasion, not influenced by the crowd. And umpire Kinnear will bounce it. Attack side of centre for the Bloods. Aptly named, but they're running on blood alone. Herbert sweeps it out to Rennie. Concedes ground to Lamb. And he hooks one into centre half forward. There's a free kick downfield. Against Stringer for an elbow. Umpire Hilton having a chat to Alan Stringer now. And Andrews, somewhat of a folk hero down here at the moment. He's kicked four goals today. This is only his sixth kick. Right into the square, coming back. He's got it. Five goals, Andrews, from six kicks. That's percentage. Football, 15-14 the Bloods, or 16-14, 17-14 Glenelg. Attack on the ball. It's total. Andrews kicks it in to give Dreher the chance. Under the ball, though, is Hamilton. Rainstringer smashed it further afield. Now Seabone. Great running player, Seabone. Puts it out in front of Kernahan, but I think he's kicked out on the full. He has. Craig Williams is at centre wing. Derek Shaw is on his own. He'll get it next. A couple of loose West Adelaide players out there, but the kick wasn't too good. Great work, McKinnon. Now Hamilton kicks it up forward. Seabone under the ball again. He's a very steady player here.
Dreher can hardly walk, Peter. He's got a leg injury as well. And what with he and Miller in the forward line, the Bay defence should be getting it fairly easily. Scott Salisbury, David Kernahan off the half-back line, a long kick out of defence, leading in the race to its Murett. He beat Marshall to it. He'll go short to Rennie centre field. Out wide is still his Lamb if he wants him. It'll come across this way. They haven't gained a great deal of ground. Now Lamb goes long. Des Herbert gets a good sit on it. One to beat. He goes around McDermott. Puts it in high, but it's all Bay players leading to the race to the ball. And Seabone takes the easy chest mark. West Adelaide forward line is just a bunch of dribbles at the moment.
There's no one in the Glenelg forward line that hardly in. It's amazing. There's hardly anyone up there.
McDermott, Gibbs, ducked ahead, got a free kick. That's centre-half back. Mr. Cool normally lost his cool a bit with Ronnie Andrews at centre wing a little while ago, but lost him the footy. Gavin Rooks at centre wing to put the Bays into attack. They've got a 7-point lead. Kernahan, Williams, Rennie, Derek Shaw. Lumbers off the half back line and kicks long to the half forward line. One on three back there. Filkey at the back of the pack. Got to use his pace. He's collared, swung off the footy. And it's Scott Salisbury who gets it out now. To Walsh. In turn, Stringer. Back to Walsh in the 1-2. And he'll go for a gallop. Down the grandstand side. Copping wants it in long. He's going for Carey. End or Copping. Carey in front. Copping behind. One grab. Tango's out of trouble. This way, that away. Back to McGuiness. Copping's got it back again, but he can't get it clear. And the umpire will come in and bounce the ball in the Bay left full forward pocket.
It is that man, Gavin Walsh. They want to get a few kicks, Pete. That's a tackle goal. He's got the long direct kick.
Yes, he has, Robert. Off hands, McGuiness. Now Copping sets it up, puts it through. Copping's got six. Oh, what a danger man, Copping. 16 goals in 2 weeks. Henwood on, Thompson on. And Glenelg have got another breather.
Tony McGuiness giving a handball then. Sometimes a little bit hesitant on the handball, but he certainly got it over very quickly to Stephen Copping. Good understanding. Glenelg just getting that ascendancy now, as one would have expected them to have some time ago. But even now, they're getting their players well into defence. There's not a lot of confidence up forward at the moment. Players are defending still. They haven't got that run-on confidence to receive they had late last week.
18 minutes gone, final quarter. The Bays with a 13-point advantage. Marshall winds his way out of trouble easily. On the left leg, he goes in long. On the leaders, Copping again. Coming back, Rennie. Copping. He's got Stringer clear. If he can get it to David Kernahan, then to Stringer. Stringer out, but it won't get there. And Rennie, intercepting well, takes the mark in the back pocket. Rennie looking for someone. Not a great deal of run on the West Adelaide school now. Walsh in the action, takes the easy mark. Both Filkey and Hamilton elected to let the other take it. Walsh kicks long in towards full forward, copping at the back, but in front Shaw. Or is it Micken? Micken it is, and he takes the mark. Goes short to Lamb. Lamb on the half-back line, thought about Cantalastis, but he's got a long kick. He puts it up for Filkey. He's come back into defence. He's on the defensive corner of the square. Filkey now gives it to Shaw, who's going to kick on that left leg. Puts it out wide of Luders. Luders is going to have to work hard for it. Beautiful sidestep, Stringer, Simons. The Bays go again out in front of Copping. Beautifully put, Tony Simons. And Copping's got it 45, 50 metres out. He'll put it into McGuiness. And the Bays starting to run him off now. McGuiness goes down. Umpire Hilton is going to put him back 15 metres. And that will bring McGuiness to within about 20 metres of goal. And if he kicks this, it could be game, set, and match. West Adelaide have put up a tremendously courageous fight. But lack of numbers, lack of fit legs, and the skill of the Bays have
taken their toll. 14 kicks coming up McGuiness. Been a damaging player. 20 metres out. McGuiness blasts it through for his second. That could be game, set and match. 2015 Glenelg, 17-14 West Adelaide.
We stated earlier in the game how important it was for West Adelaide to maintain their accuracy, to make sure that they get it from body to body so that the pressure's not brought on them in rebound. But on that occasion, Derek Shaw's kick was just underdone a little bit, and when it hit the ground, it just popped up, and Wayne Stringer was able to intercept the ball and run it down the ground. And then Tony McGuiness taking the ball inside half forward, and he got a 15-metre penalty, and that's sewn the game up.
Steve Thompson in ruck against Williams. Thompson probably got the better of that. Bennett got it back quickly, stolen by Marshall. Beautifully done. Now copping and faulting. Faulting too much pace on this occasion. Kicks out, finds Bennett. He's at half back. The Bloods have got a lot of work to do if they want to get out of this one. Luders in front, good mark. He's in the centre of the ground. Passes it out. The only way they can get it up there is to run it forward. Andrews behind, forgot to spoil away, but Duthie appeared to have a bit of an ankle injury then, but he looks all right. Seabone, Wayne Stringer, off he goes. Kernahan is on his own, he'll play it on, oh, he went before he had it. Derek Shaw, Kernahan still fighting hard, wanting to make amends for that mistake. Derek Shaw, but it's gone out of bounds. 135 to 116. The difference 19 points. The Bloods in trouble, as we guessed in that third quarter. They put a lot into the game on that occasion. Through goes McGuiness, puts in a very high ball. Carey, Micken, off hands. Cantalaptis, he was dragged. Popping, picked it up, kicked the goal, his seventh. That's it, no doubt about it now. 21-15 the Bays, the Bloods 17-14.
Glenelg came away with the premiership points from Richmond Oval this afternoon, defeating a somewhat depleted and injured West Adelaide side. The final scoreline, Glenelg 23-17, 155 points, to West Adelaide 20 goals, 14, 134. And the leading goal kickers for Glenelg, Stephen Copping got 8, and Tony McGuiness got 3, and congratulations to Tony today, celebrating his 21st. And for West Adelaide, Ron Andrews got 6, Roger Luders 3, and Bernie Conlon 3. And the stats from Richmond this afternoon: in the kicks department, Glenelg 228 to West Adelaide 219. The marks 96 to 85. Handballs 105 to 104. The free kicks 22 to Glenelg and 24 to West Adelaide. And the rucks 14 to 10. And scoring shots, well, Glenelg had 40 to West Adelaide's 34. And it's our pleasure to have with us in the studio tonight the acting captain today of West Adelaide, Peter Murett. Welcome, Peter.
Thanks, Rick.
Pretty courageous performance today by the boys. It must be damn hard to win a game of football when you've got 15 or 16 fit players. How did you see the overall performance?
Well, there's a couple of players there that it didn't really happen in the game. It happened last week, and the players declared themselves fit. And you can't go, you know, if you declare yourself fit, you've got to give 100%, and I don't think a couple of players did today.
Surprise move to start the game off with, Mark Dreher starting in a forward pocket.
Well, maybe that what I just said wasn't really towards Mark. He was picked to play, and we needed a bit of strength down there. And if Copping got it on top of Faulting, the move was for Dreher to go down on there, which did happen actually. But then Mark done his other ankle, I think, today, and John Faulting had to go back. And in the last quarter there, Glenelg just ran the ball out from defence because Mark and Stephen Miller couldn't really keep up.
What's the latest on Mike Smith's injury?
I just left Mike up in the hospital. He's having an operation tomorrow morning. He's going to have his shoulder pinned, and you know, it's not good for us because he's a very elusive half-forward flanker.
Grantley Filkey certainly produced some very exciting play, though, when he went onto the ball. Peter, compared with his wing play, I thought he played an excellent part today in the game. What did you think of that?
Yes, I did. Grantley's pace is electrifying, and you give Grantley the ball, and he's always seemed to have time to deliver the ball, and sometimes as you were just talking before, he doesn't really run in a straight line at goals, and maybe that is one of his downfalls. But the guy who gets so many kicks, he's just putting us into attack time after time after time.
Roger Luders was very impressive today for me. In other years, you've seen Roger fly, and he's always been quick recovery, but his action at the ball seems to be much improved to me. He played a very impressive game before, except for his kicking again.
Yeah. Well, Neil Curley used to say that Roger was the best tackler after the ball hit the ground, his pace to get to the opposition player was the best he's ever seen from anyone. So that's a big rap coming from Curley. So he's certainly got something.
Peter, it's an old theory. Sorry,
go ahead. You've got 1,001 questions.
Yeah, I was really in the gear tonight, trying to slip in. It's an old theory in footy that good sides win their home games. Now, you've had two home games, a loss to Woodville, and now a loss to Glenelg. It must be some sort of a concern, or do you think you play better away from Richmond Oval?
Well, our record proves it this year that we have. But today, maybe there was an excuse today, and I don't like to make excuses, because, you know, as I said, you go out there with 20 fit players, but... Now, the game was there for us today, and we should have won it, but we didn't, and it's disappointing to everyone that was involved in that today.
Your ruck play in particular, you went out with a plan, obviously, with Kernahan and Shaw standing each other, and Carey and Micken. That was obviously a preconceived plan.
Yes, it was, Robert. Peter Carey was going to be manned by Mark Micken and Stephen Kernahan by Derek Shaw, and I thought it worked. They weren't dominant around the goals. I don't know how many goals Carey and Kernahan got, but... They nullified their brilliance around the ground, I thought.
Yeah, the lad Derek Shaw's kicking's impressive for a big fellow.
Yes, certainly is. He's he can kick both feet, which everyone should be able to do. But when he gets the ball, he always does something to it, with it, I should say. And you know, it's good to have Derek in the side.
What about your own move? You had to get out the centre half forward when Mike Smith went down, and you went out the centre half forward. I thought you enjoyed it out there with a bit of room to move. Everyone told me you were too slow, but you didn't seem to be getting left behind today.
But who said that? Yeah, but no, I enjoy it. Whatever position I put in, I always try to give them 100%. And but you do seem to see the ball a lot clearly coming out of centre half forward position, and that's where the ball is mainly kicked all the time too, the centre half forward position. So yeah, you certainly get your share of balls coming that way.
Pete, do you have much goal kicking practice at Richmond during the week? You know, I don't say that facetiously, but I've been to see a lot of league clubs train, or I go along. I haven't been to West Adelaide yet. Do you actually shoot for goal at training, or do you just leave it, you know, to do it during the course of a game?
I took training on Monday night. We did have goal kicking practice. Maybe
because you're an old coach, aren't you? Really?
Yeah. But we have this exercise where we run the ball up and down the centre around like a circle work exercise, and we do take the ball into the goals. And you know, bad football today. You can't win games when you like
missing those easy shots. Brantley felt you missed a couple there, and yourself.
Yeah, we all did.
Hit the post. Yeah. That sort of stuff. Yeah. It's depressing, really.
Certainly is.
Well, Peter, thanks for joining us tonight, and good to see you back from Broken Hill and back with West Adelaide this year, and perhaps all the best for the remainder of what's left for 85.
Well, there's plenty of time left for us, Rick. I think we're only about 1.5 games or 2 games out of the 5. And
no, you're nothing out of the 5. Your percentage out of the 5.
Oh, well, so there you are. And all is not lost, and you know, all we've got to do is keep working hard, and the results will be there. And I thought today that the results, you know, the signs were there for us today. And who knows, you know, we play North next week at Prospect, and, you know, we've certainly got something to prove.
Could be a repeat of, 1983 when you win premiers?
Well, I'd like to say something about it. I think we live in the past, actually, at West Adelaide now. 83 is gone now, and 84 is gone. It's 85, and I think if we start realising that 83 is gone and 85 is here, we might start winning a few more matches. I think a few of us live in the past.
Do you wish, just on that comment, do you wish now that maybe you hadn't have won the Escort Cup or done so well in it?
Oh, no, you...
You're not still living on that, maybe?
No, I don't think so. Yeah. Maybe the other sides have improved and watched us and picked up our brilliance, I'd say.
Thanks for your comments, Peter, and as I said, good luck for the rest of 1985. Well, that wraps up the game today from down at the Richmond Oval.